Nuruddin Ali of Cairo and his son Bedreddin Hassan, from the Arabian Nights, translated by John Payne, narrated by B.J. Harrison. There was once in the land of Egypt a just and pious king who loved the poor and companied with the learned. And he had a vizier, a wise and experienced man, well versed in affairs and in the art of government. This vizier, who was a very old man, had two sons, as they were two moons. Never was seen their like for beauty and grace. The elder called Shemseddin Mohammed, and the younger Nuruddin Ali. But the younger excelled his brother in comeliness and fair favor, so that folk heard of him in distant lands, and journeyed to Egypt to get sight of him. After a while, the vizier died, to the great grief of the sultan, who sent for his two sons and invested them with robes of honor, saying,
"Let not your hearts be troubled, for you shall stand in your father's stead and be joint viziers of Egypt."
At this they were glad and kissed the earth before him and mourned for their father a whole month, at the end of which time they entered upon the vizierate and the government passed into their hands as it had been in those of their father, each ruling for a week at a time. Whenever the sultan went on a journey, they took it in turns to accompany him. And the two brothers lived in one house, and there was perfect accord between them. It chanced one night that the sultan proposed setting out on a journey on the morrow, and the elder, whose turn it was to attend him, was sitting talking with his brother, and said to him,
"Oh, my brother, it is my wish that we both marry and go into our wives on the same night."
"Oh, my brother," replied Nuruddin, "do as thou wilt. I will conform to thee."
So they agreed upon this, and Shemseddin said,
"If it be the will of God that we both marry on the same night, and our wives be brought to bed on the same day, and thy wife bear a boy, and mine a girl, we will marry the children to one another, for they will be cousins."
"Oh, my brother," asked Nuruddin, "what dowry wilt thou require of my son for thy daughter?"
Quoth the other,
"I will have of him 3,000 dinars, and 3 gardens, and 3 farms, for it would not be fitting that he bring her a smaller dowry than this."
When Nuruddin heard this, he said,
"What dowry is this thou wilt impose on my son? Knowest thou not that we are brothers, and both by God's grace viziers, and equal in rank? It behooves thee to offer thy daughter to my son without dowry. Or if thou must have a dower, it should be something of nominal value for mere show. For thou knowest the male to be more worthy than the female, and my son is a male, and our memory will be preserved by him, not by thy daughter. But I see thou wouldst do with me according to the saying, 'If thou wouldst drive away a purchaser, ask him a high price,' or as did one, who, being asked by a friend to do him a favor, replied, 'In the name of God, I will comply with thy request, but not till tomorrow.' Whereupon the other answered him with this verse, 'When one of whom a favor's asked postpones it till next day, 'tis to a man who knows the world as if he said him nay.'"
Quoth Shemseddin, "Verily, thou errest, in that thou wouldst make thy son more worthy than my daughter, and it is plain that thou lackest both judgment and manners. Thou talkest of thy share in the vizierate, when I only admitted thee to share with me in pity for thee, not wishing to mortify thee, and that thou mightest help me. But since thou talkest thus, by Allah, I will not marry my daughter to thy son,
though thou pay down her weight in gold.
When Nuruddin heard this, he was angry and said,
And I will never marry my son to thy daughter.
I would not accept him as a husband for her, answered the other. And were I not bound to attend the Sultan on his journey, I would make an example of thee. But when I return, I will let thee see what my dignity demands.
When Nuruddin heard this speech from his brother, he was beside himself for rage, but held his peace and stifled his vexation. And each passed the night in his own place, full of wrath against the other. As soon as it was day, the Sultan went out to Giza and made for the pyramids, accompanied by the vizier Shamsuddin, whilst Nuruddin arose, sore enraged, and prayed the morning prayer. Then he went to his treasury, and taking a small pair of saddlebags, filled them with gold. And he called to mind his brother's words, and the contempt with which he had treated him, and repeated the following verses. Travel, for you shall find new friends in place of those you leave, and labor, for in toil, indeed, the sweets of life reside. Nor gain nor honor comes to him who idly stays at home. So leave thy native land behind, and journey far and wide. Oft have I seen a stagnant pool corrupt with standing still. If water run, 'tis sweet, but else grows quickly putrefied. If the full moon were always high and never waned nor set, men would not strain their watchful eyes for it at every tide. Except the arrow leave the bow, 'twill never hit the mark, nor will the lion chance on prey if in the copse he bide. The aloes in its native land a kind of firewood is, and precious metals are but dust whilst in the mine they hide. The one is sent abroad and grows more precious straight than gold, the other's brought to light and finds its value magnified. Then he bade one of his people saddle him his mule with a padded saddle. Now she was a dapple mule, high-backed, like a dome builded upon columns. Her saddle was of cloth of gold, and her stirrups of Indian steel, her housings of Ispahan velvet, and she was like a bride on her wedding night. Moreover, he bade lay on her back a carpet of silk, and strap the saddlebags on that, and spread a prayer rug over the whole. The man did as he bade him, and Nuruddin said to his servants, I have a mind to ride out a pleasuring towards Kelubia, and I shall lie 3 nights abroad, but let none of you follow me, for my heart is heavy. Then he mounted the mule in haste, and set out from Cairo, taking with him a little victual, and made for the open country. About midday, he reached the town of Belbeis, where he alighted and rested himself and the mule. Then he took out food and ate and fared on again in the direction of the desert, after having bought victual and fodder for the mule in the town. Towards nightfall, he came to a town called Sadia, where he alighted and took out food and ate, then spread the carpet on the ground, and laying the saddlebags under his head, slept in the open air, for he was still overcome with anger. As soon as it was day, he mounted and rode onward, till he reached the city of Jerusalem, and thence to Aleppo, where he alighted at one of the khans, and abode 3 days, to rest himself and the mule. Then, being still intent upon travel, he mounted, and setting out again, he knew not whither, journeyed on without ceasing, till he reached the city of Bassora, where he alighted at a certain khan and spread out his prayer carpet, after having taken the saddlebags off the mule's back and given her to the porter that he might walk her about. As chance would have it, the vizier of Bassora, who was a very old man, was sitting at a window of his palace opposite the khan and saw the porter walking the mule up and down. He remarked her costly trappings and took her to be a mule of parade, of such as are ridden by kings and viziers. This set him thinking, and he became perplexed and said to one of his servants,
"Bring me yonder porter."
So the servant went and returned with the porter, who kissed the ground before the vizier, and the latter said to him,
"Who is the owner of that mule, and what manner of man is he?"
"O my lord," replied the porter, "he is a comely young man of the sons of the merchants, grave and dignified of aspect."
When the vizier heard this, he rose at once, and mounting his horse, rode to the Khan, and went in to Nuradin, who, seeing him making towards himself, rose, and went to meet him and saluted him. The vizier bade him welcome to Basura, and dismounting, embraced him and made him sit down by his side, and said to him,
"O my son, whence comest thou, and what dost thou seek?"
"O my lord," answered Nuradin, "I come from the city of Cairo,"
and told him his story from beginning to end, saying, "I am resolved not to return home till I have seen all the towns and countries of the world." When the vizier heard this, he said to him,
"O my son, follow not the promptings of thy soul, lest they bring thee into peril. For indeed the lands are waste, and I fear the issues of fortune for thee."
Then he let load the saddlebags and the carpets on the mule, and carried Nuradin to his own house, where he lodged him in a pleasant place, and made much of him, for he had conceived a great affection for him. After a while he said to him,
"O my son, I am an old man, and have no male child, but God has given me a daughter, who is thy match for beauty, and I have refused many suitors for her hand. But love of thee has caught hold upon my heart. So wilt thou accept of my daughter to thine handmaid, and be her husband? If thou consent to this, I will carry thee to the Sultan of Basra, and tell him that thou art my brother's son, and bring thee to be appointed vizier in my stead, that I may keep the house. For by Allah, my son, I am a very old man, and I am weary."
When Nuradin heard the vizier's proposal, he bowed his head a while, then raised it and answered,
"I hear and obey."
At this the vizier rejoiced and bade his servants decorate the great hall, in which they were wont to celebrate the marriages of nobles. Then he assembled his friends and the notables of the kingdom and the merchants of...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.